As you probably know, this year's Keswick Bible Convention was cancelled, which was a great disappointment to the 12,000 to 15,000 adults and children who would have attended, including at least 12 from BREC. Instead, the Keswick Ministries team arranged for some of the key elements of the convention to be transmitted on the internet. For the next 2 weeks, our Sunday morning services will include some talks given at this year's virtually Keswick Convention. The overall theme for the convention was the Christian hope. Later in our service this morning, Mike Cain, a pastor from Bristol, will be bringing us his talk entitled Why Hope? But first, a contribution from the Keswick Youth Programme. It is a word picture entitled Hope Because Jesus Rules.
How do you feel when you're told what to do? Does it make you sulk? Does it make you stew? Are you ever happy to receive direction? Is authority met in you with acceptance or rejection? See, our culture has the weirdest relationship with our leaders. We want them to be wise, go-getters, achievers, and yet the rebel is prized as heroic and tough. An example to follow, a diamond in the rough. We want our politicians to be commanding and direct. We want to have authority figures that we can respect, and yet we also live in fear that their ruling is wrong, that they'll make bad decisions and lead us along the wrong path, till we end up hopelessly lost. The news is full of their mistakes and the cost of the dangers of corruption, hypocrisy and bias, of how they're not fit to lead us, they're truth twisters, they're liars. But let me shift gears for a sec. Let's shift our focus too. How do you feel about those who rule over you? Your teachers, your parents, perhaps a boss at work. Do these people make you happy? Do they make you go berserk? See, deep down, I think we all just want to have freedom unchained, an answer to no one, to play our own game, to be our own captain, to be our own king, to write our own rules, our own song to sing. And yet there's this nagging reality that I think we all know, that when we chart our own course, it doesn't often go well. In fact, I think it's the reverse, and the reason is we're all affected by the same curse from back in the garden when we ate from the one tree that we were commanded to leave, but we couldn't see, blinded by our greed and our selfishness and our pride. But when God came and called out, we found places to hide. See, the truth deep inside that we can't continue to ignore is that we're not fit to rule our lives any more than those others we've mentioned who get so much wrong. See, no one is perfect, not even one. True freedom is not found in being the captain of my own soul. True freedom is not found in setting my own goals. True freedom is found in living the life that I've been made for, in following the course that's been charted by my maker. See, it's not authority per se that causes us grief. It's the people who have it who shake our belief. If only it was possible to have a leader who embodied perfection, then our posture would shift from suspicion to affection. And the wonderful truth that the Bible proclaims is that the one who really reigns is the one who died and rose again. One day he'll return in glory, appearing, destroying all evil and ending all weeping. And so while we wait, no matter how it feels, King Jesus is reigning. He's molding the clay on his potter's wheel. So friends, rest assured, you have a ruler above who's reigning with wisdom and power and love.
Now we will join together in prayer to our Almighty God, who Jesus told us we could call Father. Heavenly Father, we come to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who is the same yesterday and today and forever. We thank you for that reassurance in the disrupted and difficult time the world is going through. We pray that we may experience the peace you give us, which is beyond all understanding. As the coronavirus pandemic is like no other time in living memory, we pray for wisdom for all leaders as they seek the way forward in every area of life, both nationally and internationally. We pray for those who are working to make schools and workplaces safe to open. We pray for guidance as they apply the rules and guidelines in their locations. for those young people who have been disappointed in their exam results, that they may find ways forward in their plans for the future. For those who are suffering difficult long-term effects of the virus. We pray about the stress that the situation is causing many people and the long-term effects on the mental health of the nation. We pray for Lebanon as the country deals with the aftermath of the explosion in Beirut. We ask that aid that is being provided will reach those who need it. We remember the work being done by Doug Barnett's friend Ronnie, and pray that Christians will be able to point others to you, the God of all comfort. We remember before you all the areas of the world that have slipped from the headlines in recent months, places where there are continuing wars, political unrest, persecution, poverty and other forms of hardship, disruption and hurt for millions of people. We thank you for the leadership at BREC and pray that they may have your wisdom as they plan the life of the church in the future. Thank you for the service each Sunday that links us together and points us to you. For ourselves, we ask that we may stay faithful to you and your word, and that way you may become more like Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. And now our Bible reading will be read by Mabel.
2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 13 to 17. But we ought always to thank God for you, brothers and sisters, loved by the Lord, because God chose you as first fruits to be saved through the sanctifying work of the Spirit and through belief in the truth. He called you to this through our gospel, that you might share in the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. So then, brothers and sisters, stand firm and hold fast to the teachings we passed on to you, whether by word of the mouth or letter. May our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and by his grace gave us eternal encouragement and good hope, encourage your hearts and strengthen you in every good deed and word.
Before we watch today's talk, the title of which is Why Hope? Let us sing a song which reminds us that because Jesus died on the cross to set us free from our sins, we can be forgiven, and that he conquered death when he rose again on the third day. And if that is true for us, we can acknowledge, as the song states, that Jesus Christ is my living hope. I trust we can all claim that statement for ourselves today.
Between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? Heart could fathom such boundless grace. The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me. Savior, I'm yours forever. silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe out of the silence.
Hope is like a holiday. You're worn out, so you book a holiday. And the holiday is months away, but what happens to you? Soon as it's booked, you start dreaming of the day you can stretch out on the shore of Derwentwater, or climb Helvellyn, or just take in the view of Buttermere. Having a holiday to look forward to in the future gives you strength to keep going in the present. And Paul is writing to the Thessalonians, and he's writing to us about the future that we have to look forward to. The day of the Lord, he calls it. The day when Jesus comes again and deals with all that is wrong in this world and puts everything right. The word that Paul uses to describe it is glory. Jesus's glory is his brilliance. And he says that when Jesus comes again, we will see him and marvel at his brilliance. He will restore creation. He'll restore it to what it was meant to be. And we will look at the world made new, and we'll see it as a world without disease. A world without death, because a world without sin. And we will look at what he has done and we will say, isn't he brilliant? He will restore creation. And he will restore us to what we were meant to be. Back in chapter 1, verse 10, Paul talks of Jesus being glorified in his people. He will mend our broken hearts. He will fix our broken lives, and he will make us like him. And we will look at each other and we will say, look at what he has done. Isn't he brilliant? And back in 1 Thessalonians, Paul reminds them of how they had turned from idols to serve the living and true God, to wait for his Son from heaven. The Thessalonians were waiting for Jesus. They were dreaming of the day when Jesus comes back to make all things new. They were looking forward to glory. And that's the future. That's the future that gave them strength to keep going in the present, because right now, we read in chapter 1, verse 4, they are facing persecutions and trials. But they keep going. They keep going because they have got the day of the Lord to look forward to. Right now, we might be crying, but we keep going. We keep going because one day he will wipe all our tears dry. And then some people start going round and telling the Thessalonians that the day of the Lord has already come, that Jesus is not coming back to make all things new. There's nothing to look forward to, that this is it. This world of trials and tears, this is as good as it gets. How did you feel when your holiday was cancelled by COVID? It's hard to keep going through the grind of life if there's nothing to look forward to. And friends, we may not have people telling us that the day of the Lord has been cancelled, but maybe on some level we've just lost confidence that Jesus is coming again, that Jesus is going to deal with all that's wrong. He's going to put everything right, wipe all my tears, make all things new? Really? If we're not sure if the holiday is coming in the future, it's hard to keep going when today is tough. When following Jesus costs us, when standing for him means we get hurt, hard to keep going if we're not sure about the future. Feels like we're in a small boat on a big sea and there is no sign of land. It's hard to keep going. See what Paul says back in chapter 2, verse 3. He says, "We ask you, brothers and sisters, not to become easily unsettled." Doesn't want us to become unsettled. He doesn't want us to capsize in the Christian life. He's heading all to chapter 2, verse 15, where he says, "So then, brothers and sisters, stand firm." He wants us to stand firm. And so the first thing he does is insist that the day of the Lord has not been cancelled. Jesus is coming again. And I wonder if you've lost confidence and whether that's really true. Back in 1 Thessalonians chapter 1 verse 10, Paul connects the coming again of Jesus to the resurrection of Jesus. He talks about how the Thessalonians are waiting for the Son from heaven whom the Lord raised from the dead. It's the resurrection that gives us confidence, that shows us this is not all there is more, that shows us Jesus is alive and he's king and he's coming back. And the point is, he's coming back to finish what he started. There's a guy who came to fix our boiler, and he came and he opened it up and he was with us about 10 minutes and then he went away, said he had to get some parts. We didn't sit there wondering if he was going to come back or not. We knew, you see, we knew he hadn't just come to open up the boiler. The whole point of his coming was to fix it. He'd started, but he'd not finished. So we knew he'd come back to finish it. And he did. And friend, the salvation that Jesus came to bring is bigger than we sometimes think. Jesus didn't just come to die and rise and disappear and leave us to it. He came to restore the world to how it was meant to be. And you look at his resurrection and you see the beginnings of the new creation. You see he's started, But you look around, it's very obvious that he's not yet finished. So will he come back? Yes. Because salvation is bigger than we think. Coming back is not the odd bit tacked on at the end. It's about finishing what he started. He came, which means he will come again. And we live in a world in which plans change. Holidays fall through. The future is very uncertain. But if we are Christians, we have what Paul calls a good hope. A good hope, a future to look forward to that will not be cancelled. The day of the Lord is coming. The one who came will come again to finish what he has started, to make all things new, glory. And what Paul says in chapter 2, verses 1 to 12, is between now and that day, the world will be awash with lies. Lies that will deceive people and lead them away from God. Lies that will mean that when Jesus comes, instead of being invited into glory, they'll be shut out. As he says in chapter 2, verse 12, condemned. We had to back up a bit to feel what's at stake in our verses. You see, they were unsettled. And Paul settled them. The day of the Lord is coming. But can you see that in settling them, Paul might have unsettled them again? Because the day of the Lord is coming, but between now and then, if the world is awash with lies, what's to stop us from falling for them? What's to stop us being deceived? The voices in the papers, every film we see, every song we hear, the voices at school and in college, at work, saying, how can you be so arrogant? How can you be so arrogant as to claim to have the truth? There are lots of different ways of seeing things. Oh, it's people like you. It's people like you cause division. It's people like you who peddle hate. You've just got to let people be true to who they want to be. Do what they want to do. And what they say sounds so attractive. I don't want them to think that I'm intolerant or hateful. I want them to like me. And so the day of the Lord is coming. But I feel like I'm in a small boat on a very big sea, blown around by a hostile world. And there are days when I fear I am going to capsize. So yes, glory is coming. But I'm just not sure if I will be part of it. Because I'm not sure if I can keep going. You feel that? Here's what Paul wants you to know. Yes, the devil is at work in this world, but so is God. And he is at work in you, and he has got hold of you. God has got hold of you for glory. That's the message of these verses in one line. God has got hold of you for glory. In these verses, look who the hero is. Verse 13, but we ought always to thank God for you, brothers and sisters. But why thank God for you? Because the story of your lives is the story of what he is doing. Verse 13, they are loved by the Lord. Verse 13, because God chose you. Verse 14, he called you. See, there I am thinking, I'm in my small boat on this big sea, and I'm not sure if I can keep going. And what Paul is saying is, I can keep going because God, he has got hold of me for glory. Let's just take in the medicine of these words. loved by the Lord. We look down the years ahead and we worry. In the face of a hostile world, what if my love for him grows cold? But do you see? He's the hero. Do you see? It's not about your love for him, it's about his love for you. Look at verse 16. May our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us. Typical Paul, loved us. Past tense. You want to know how much God loves you? Look back to the cross. Look at Jesus. See a love that is prepared to lay down its life for you. Small boat, big sea. People are going to hate you for what you believe. It's going to be really hard. But whatever happens, the Lord loves you. He's never going to stop loving you. And that's because he chose you. It's a wonderful thing to be chosen, to have someone set their heart on you. Normally you get chosen because you deserve a place on the team, because you're fast or you're successful or you're funny, and it makes you feel really good about yourself. They chose me. But what happens when you lose your speed, or you're not so successful, or you don't make people laugh anymore? You get dropped. It's not like that with God. God chose you as first fruits, or if you look at the footnote, because from the beginning, God chose you. From the beginning. At the beginning, before we were born, what had we done to deserve our place on God's team? Nothing. So do you see? There you are in your small boat on this big sea thinking, I'm going to blow it. I'm going to mess up. I'm going to mess up and God will drop me. No. God chose you. He set his heart on you from the beginning. There's nothing you did to deserve it. Which means there's nothing you can do to undeserve it. Which means he's never going to drop you. And do you see why he has chosen us, loved us, chosen us to be saved? It's a contrast with verse 12, a world of people who will be condemned because they don't believe the truth. And that's what we fear. What if that's me? And Paul is reassuring us. He's saying God chose you to be saved, not condemned, but saved, to be people who do believe the truth. Do you see? To be saved through the sanctifying work of the Spirit and through belief in the truth. And even your believing in the truth, you see how even that is the Spirit's work? Even that is what he is doing in you. It's his work. Paul, are you sure? You sure he's at work in us? You sure he's got hold of us? Paul says, don't you remember? Don't you remember when he called you through our gospel? Verse 14, he called you to this through our gospel. Yeah, it's language that picks up on what he said to them before. He's saying, don't you remember? When we preached the gospel to you, do you remember how that gospel turned your lives around? You turned from idols to serve the living God, to wait for his Son from heaven. There was a time when you didn't care about being ready for the day of the Lord. But the very fact that today you care, that you want to be there, shows that something in your heart has changed. God has called you. God has got hold of you. And friends, do you see why he's got hold of you? That you might share in the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. He's got hold of you so that when Jesus comes again in glory and the world sees his brilliance, you will not be shut out. You will share in it. People will look at you and marvel at what he has done. And friends, I know that the idea of God choosing us raises all kinds of questions, but do you see what a relief it is? A hostile world, awash with lies. By myself, it's very hard for me to keep hold of him. Do you see what a relief it is that he has got hold of me? See what Paul says in verse 16. Our God is the God who loved us and by his grace gave us eternal encouragement and good hope. The good hope that is ours, that holiday that's never going to be cancelled, is ours. Why? Because by his grace, he gave it to us. See, if glory was something I had to get for myself, not a chance. Small boat, big sea, capsize. But the future is guaranteed because glory is a gift he gave to me. When I was 10, I dreamed of going to Lord's, the cricket ground, to watch a test match. But how could I get there? Or even if I could afford a ticket, how would I know which train to catch to London? How would I know how to find my way across London on the Underground? And the whole idea made me nervous. I was just frightened of the crowds. But that summer, I got to Lord's. In the late August sunshine, I watched a young David Gower make 71 dreamy runs against New Zealand. How did I get there? My dad took me. He bought the tickets. He drove us to the station. He got us on the right train. In the Underground, he held my hand. When we got to St. John's Wood, he led me through the crowds into the ground. Then he led me to the stand to find our seats. And I remember walking up the steps at the back of the stand in the shade, and then magical moment as we stepped out into the light, and there was Lord's in all its glory, and I was there to share in it. Why? Because my dad took me. By myself, I was never going to make it to Lord's. I was never going to get on the right train and find my way around the tube and push my way through the crowds, but I got there. I got there because Dad took me. And friends, by ourselves, we're never going to make it to glory. It's a hostile world. It's hard to follow Jesus. There's persecution and trials, and the world is awash with lies that are so attractive. If it was all down to me, I'd soon lose my way. But do you see? It isn't all down to me. It isn't all down to you. As my dad got me to Lord's, your Father in heaven has taken you by the hand and he will get you to glory. So then, verse 15, brothers and sisters, stand firm and hold fast to the teachings we passed on to you, whether by word of mouth or by letter. See, the hostile world says, you believe this stuff Paul teaches about Jesus? You believe he's coming back to judge the world? You believe this stuff about how God wants people to live? You think this is good? So tempting to walk away, isn't it? Especially when it costs us. Especially when they hate us for it. It makes for heartache. It makes for tears. And if there is no glory to come, forget it. I'll turn back. I'll just go along with everyone else. Just go along with the crowd. But you see, what we've seen is there is glory to come. Jesus is coming back to finish what he started, to make all things new. And we are going to be there. Why? Why can we be so certain? Because it's not just me in my small boat on this big sea awash with lies. Why are we going to be there? Because God has got hold of us. Did you see, 10-year-old me is halfway to Lourdes on my own. First sign of getting lost. First time I feel afraid of the crowd, I turn back. But if Dad has got hold of me, I'm not going to turn back. There are moments when I might panic and feel anxious, but I'm not turning back because my Dad is taking me to Lourdes. And friends, we're afraid of the crowds, what they say to us, do to us, the lies they tell, very attractive. So tempting to turn back, but we're not going to turn back. Because why would we turn back? Because God, our Father, is taking us to glory. And there'll be a day when we step out into the light of a world made new and marvel at what he has done, his brilliance, that we get to share in it. So stand firm. You see, but it's hard. You see what Paul prays in verse 16? May our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and by his grace gave us eternal encouragement and good hope, encourage your hearts and strengthen you in every good deed and word. Did you see what Paul prays? It's not just that glory is a gift given to us, that the Lord has kind of left tickets for us by the gate for us to collect. The point is, he is with us along the way. When we're in trials and tears, he's got us by the hand. And Paul is praying that we would know the reality of that. That we would know that we can keep going. Because Jesus Christ himself and God our Father giving us the strength to keep going. Let's pray. He called you to this through our gospel, that you might share in the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you that we have hope. We thank you that you loved us and chose us and called us to glory. And we are so aware of the world's hostility and of our weakness. And we thank you that the future doesn't depend on our keeping hold of you, but you're keeping hold of us. And for your amazing grace, we praise you. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
I trust that you found that talk inspiring and challenging, and that it will be a stimulus for each one of us as we enter a new week. Some of us will be looking forward to rest and relaxation. Some will be finding life no different to last week, while for others there will be fears, concerns, and uncertainties. I hope that for all of us, we may know the presence and peace which our Saviour, the Lord Jesus Christ, can bring us as we enter this new week. So let us pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you that we have been able to be a part of this service today. And although we cannot be together in person, we have been able to share together in praise and worship and listen to the teaching from your word. We thank you that your love for us and our love for you unites us together in these unfamiliar times. Be with us during the coming week, we pray. Support us, strengthen and watch over us, so that at the end of the week, we can again give you our thanks and praise. We offer these things in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Our final song reminds us that the Christian's hope is firmly based solely on what the Lord Jesus achieved when he died for our sins on the cross. It also emphasises, as many Christian songs do, that Jesus can be with us through the storms and trials that we may face in our lives.
Built on nothing less. dressed in his righteousness alone. Faultless stand before the throne.